Welcome to SouthPoint Church Online. We want to say hi to our Southern Maryland communities that might be joining us today. We want to say hi to those of you that might be watching in different parts of the country. We also want to welcome those of you that might be watching in different parts of the world. My name is Matt. I'm part of the team here at SouthPoint, and we really are fired up that you chose to join us this Sunday morning. Hey, we're in the last week of a series called Silent Church. Matter of fact, over the last several weeks, we've tackled some really difficult and some really hard subjects. And the reason we've been able to or willing to tackle and do difficult is for a reason that we said way back in week one, and I want to put it up on the screen, and it's this right here. And it's this, that doing nothing solves nothing, right? That if we, the church, just ignore things or hide our head in the sand, it really never fixes anything. But the second reason, there's another reason that we've been willing to handle or tackle these hard situations. And it's this, it's hope. It's hope in Christ, not in hope that we'll be good people or hope in systems, but hope in Jesus. And so today, as we've kind of come to the close, I said, we have to talk about hope and make a whole message around hope. And the reason that I feel like today that we need to talk about hope as a standalone message is a problem that you already know and that I know, and I'm gonna put up on the screen, and it's this right in the air. Our national mood, right? We have a mood kind of nationally here in our country and maybe even around the world. Our national mood of fear, negativity, hurt, divisiveness, and polarization has left many of us in the fog of despair. I mean, if we're really honest this morning, right? If you watch the news, if you read an article, if you go onto social media like Twitter or Facebook, man, it just feels toxic. It feels negative. It feels divisive. And when we go into those things, especially being socially distanced, if that's our only way to connect to the outside world, man, we can just feel like we're in a fog of despair. And so that's why this morning we want to talk about hope. A matter of fact, it was just this week I was talking to a friend through social media, and they basically put out there like, hey, can we just stop it and all be nice to each other, which I thought was kind of funny. And I kind of responded, and I want to share a quote that they shared with me that I think just reveals how much despair we may be feeling in this difficult season. And here's the quote that this friend said. They said, I just feel like things are getting way worse. It wasn't like things are just getting worse. They're getting way worse. And there's no light at the end of the tunnel. My friend in this season doesn't see any hope beyond where we're at, that things are just getting way worse. And then they said, it'll probably never get better, right? Probably never will be. Like, it's just going to stay this way, and it's scary. And I wonder how many of us today and in the last several weeks have felt like it's just never going to get better, right? And it's just scary. I mean, think about it. I mean, you and I are facing a season unprecedented in our lives. I mean, we think about, we're experiencing a pandemic that is causing the real loss of life. Matter of fact, this past Monday, I just did a funeral for someone who passed away of COVID-19. And it's not just the physical loss of life, right? And then people are losing their jobs, right? People may be losing businesses. We've lost some dreams over this spring and the start of the summer, right? I mean, people didn't get to graduate the way they wanted to. Weddings are changed, right? Vacations are getting canceled and being done differently. We just feel like life isn't all that it should be, right? And it leads us to despair. And the problem is like despair just isn't good and it isn't helpful. And it leads us to a truth this morning that I think that we need to address. And I'm going to put it up on the screen. And it's this, the lie of despair often causes us to give up when we shouldn't, right? Like as we look at this busted and broken world where like we're divided politically, where we're experiencing loss because of a pandemic, where there's racial injustice and racial discord, and where you can't even have conversations about politics because we're so divided and we're polarized, right? And then you can't even have conversations. People just, it's the cancel culture, right? It's just, it's so toxic. And so we just despair. And if we're really honest as we think about it, despair makes us want to just throw our hands up in the air and go, I give up. I'm done. I mean, maybe you just want to type in done, right? How many of you have thought that over the last month of just like, I'm just done with it all, right? And despair often causes us to give up. But here's the problem. Giving up never really solves anything, right? Can I get an amen? I mean, giving up doesn't fix anything. And I get it. When we think it's never going to get better and that it's only going to get worse, we feel despair and want to give up. But despair and giving up leads to some serious problems. Matter of fact, as I was preparing this Sunday, I thought about like when I despair, I see a pattern. And I want to share that with us this morning. I'm going to put it up on the screen, right? Despair will cause you. Despair will cause me. Despair will cause all of us. And regardless of whether you have no faith or different faith or you grew up as a follower of Jesus, despair will have the same result on all of us. First, despair will cause us to retreat, right? When we think it won't get any better, right, we will step away. Maybe we used to actually engage and be a part and try to figure out how to make the world a better place. But when we despair and we give up, we begin to retreat. And what I mean by retreat is we begin to step away. And if we're really honest in a season that we're in right now, stepping away often looks like medicating, right? We'll overeat, right? We'll oversleep. We'll over-entertain, we'll over-drink. We may look to feel better through things that aren't good for us because we begin to step away from the things that give us purpose, that give us life, because the world is so broken, we don't think it'll get any better. And so despair will cause us to retreat, where we step away and life becomes about medicating and feeling good. The second one is even scarier. It's where we begin to fortify, right? We try to make the world a better place. Our feelings get hurt. We get hurt. And this cancel culture, right? Like some of our friends will unfriend us on Facebook or say things that hurt us. And so despair will cause us to build a wall. We'll take all the stones that got thrown at us, all the stones of pain, and we'll begin to build a wall to protect us from hurt. And the reality is we begin to unfriend people who we disagree with or who hurt us, right? And we go, I don't want to be hurt the way I've been hurt. So we'll unfriend people and we begin to say them and we begin to dehumanize people. And I just want to give us a warning. Jesus says one of the things that shows us that we're not in a good place is when our heart grows cold towards other people. When you and I begin to lack empathy for people, then we know we're starting to build walls, right? So despair and giving up says we'll step away. Despair and giving up says I'm going to build a wall and I'm going to say there's an us versus them and I'm not going to engage because people have hurt me and so my heart will get cold. And lastly is that we will begin to isolate, right? We'll begin to live in an echo chamber. Like I get it, like when we've been hurt and when there's disagreement and people can't say things in a nice way and have real dialogue, right? We begin to isolate and we begin to live in what I call the echo chamber, right? We only watch the news channel that supports our view, right? We only talk to people who think like us. We're only around people who think and esteem and like and vote and look like us. We begin to isolate into communities where it's only the things that we value, we like, and we care about. And we get isolated. I mean, look at that list. We retreat, we build walls, and then we isolate in an echo chamber of communities. And the reality is, whether you have no faith or different faith, or you've been a follower of Jesus, this isn't good for us as individuals, right? Does this make us better? No, this doesn't make us better. And does this make us better as a church? And if we're really honest, we can all think of churches that have done this, right? Like this doesn't make us a better individual, and this surely doesn't make us a better community of followers of Jesus when we allow despair to cause us to retreat, to fortify, and isolate. And it leaves you and I in this very difficult season asking a really important question. And it's an important question that we need to answer to now in the here and present. Matter of fact, my hope is to answer this question today. How do we not fall into despair because of the brokenness on the outside of the world? And how do we not fall into despair because of the brokenness on the inside, right? Where then all of a sudden we retreat, we fortify, and we isolate. And then we're not better at life and we don't make life better? And we need to be able to have an answer to that question. And that's why I was so fired up and excited to come and be here this morning, because God knew that despair would be a trap that none of us should fall into. Matter of fact, falling into despair is something that Jesus regularly addressed. And this morning, I'm just really excited to share an encounter Jesus had where he turned despair into hope. And I think in this encounter with Jesus, there's some things that you and I can see and that you and I can learn from so that we won't allow despair to cause us to give up. That actually hope will transform our response to brokenness so we can do something other than give up. And so this morning, we're going to take a look at the eyewitness account of the Gospel of Luke. It's Luke 7, 11 through 17, and we're going to put it up on the screen. It's this, and it says, "Soon afterward, Jesus went to a town called Nain." Now, I just want to stop there really quickly, and I just want to make a point. Sometimes we can read things in the Bible just kind of in our hurried culture and our 144 characters, kind of like bit-sized news information. And I don't want us to miss the importance of this statement of soon afterward, Jesus went to a town. You see, Jesus wasn't waiting and watching on the sidelines. Jesus did something. He went. And I think for those of us who claim to be followers of Jesus, watching and waiting on the sideline isn't an option. We should be people who go like Jesus went. It says, "Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and after his disciples and a large crowd went along with him, and as soon as he approached the town gate," so here's a crowd, a large crowd following Jesus, and they're coming into this town, Nain, but there's kind of this gate that creates a funnel, and they're about to come into the town. And so they're coming into the town, and we pick it up, and it says this, "A dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow." Now, I want to step into this single statement, right? Like the eyewitness account, the Gospel of Luke, shares a story in a simple, single sentence. But in this single, simple sentence is beauty and brokenness. I see for you and I, wealth in life is defined a little bit different than it was in the first century. You see, in the first century, wealth was built normally through agricultural means, which means typically you would want to have land and you would want to have a large family so that you could work that land. And in that culture, women weren't esteemed the way that they should have been. And so being married was a primary economic means to survival. And so in this simple sentence, "the only son of his mother, and she was a widow." You see, at some point, this woman had experienced the beauty of life. She had gotten married, and that meant that she was going to have economic safety and love and care. And they had probably hoped for a large family, and they didn't have a large family. They only had one son, but that one son was beautiful, right? And so they got to experience some of the beauty of life. But in this simple statement, this simple sentence, we see that she became a widow. And so she lost her husband, but even in that brokenness, she still had her son. And then she experienced some more brokenness. She had to bury her one and only son. And if you've ever been a parent, you never want to bury your child. And so we see this. She had experienced the beauty of life, but then came along the brokenness of life and ruined it. And she was crushed. And it said, a large crowd came from the town that was with her. And I want to stop here and hang on this. You notice that there was a large group of people that saw her pain and supported her. And I think the reason that there was such a large group that was around her and supporting her is because they saw that the brokenness of life had ruined the beauty of life, right? And the reality is that all of us, whether you have no faith, different faith, or you've grown up as a follower of Jesus, I bet all of us watching today have experienced what she experienced. And the reason that the crowd was so behind her is because we've all seen the beauty in our life be ruined by the brokenness of life. And so they could relate to her. And when they saw her story, that she was a widow who was bearing her only son, and how the brokenness of life had ruined the beauty of her life, they too had seen that and experienced that. And they were grieving with her, and they were grieving the pain of real life loss. And then it continues, this counter and continues, and it says, nope, we want to stay there just for 1 second. When the Lord saw her, now I just want to stop here for a second, and I just want to go a little old school and preach to you today. Because I know for many of us, when we experience the brokenness of life, we often ask this question, where are you, God? God, do you even see? And I love this verse, and it says, when the Lord saw her. I want to share to anyone this morning that it is not an if question, if God sees you. God does see you. It is a when question. God absolutely sees you. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, don't cry. For any of you that are showing up today, and the brokenness has ruined the beauty of life, I want you to know, God, it isn't an if question. He sees you, and his heart goes out. And then the statement that Jesus makes is a little bit odd. He says, don't cry. So in this little few sentences that Luke gives us, we see three specific things. We see the beauty of life ruined by the brokenness of life. We see a community that gathers around real pain. And lastly, we see that she's about to have an encounter that she didn't expect. Because Jesus' statement seems odd. Don't cry. Well, she should cry. She's a widow and she's lost her only son. And here's the thing. That isn't the end of the story. There's a group where Jesus meets this group at the town gate. One is in despair. And this is where we're going to encounter the rest of the verse. We're going to move on to the next part. And it says, then he went up and he touched the briar where they were carrying him on. Now, for you and I, doesn't that look beautiful? Jesus is touching. And when you and I imagine this phrase, we imagine a coffin. But in first century, it isn't a coffin. It's probably some stretcher, something that they're either going to bury or burn the son on. It's a briar. It's like it's not a coffin, right? But here's what's crazy is that he touched the briar. Now, you have to understand, in the pagan culture of this first century where Luke is recording, touching dead people or touching death was taboo. You see, there was this myth, this kind of superstition around the idea that if you were around death or touched death, that it would be communicated to you that you would be surrounded by death. And so no one in the pagan world wanted to be around death, touch death, do anything like that, because you only wanted to surround yourself with life. And in the Jewish value where God had spoken, he said you would be ceremonially unclean by touching a dead body. And this is why it's so important. You need to, if you're distracted by kids or you're on your phone or laptop, I want you to step into this. You see, Jesus wasn't worried about touching the death in someone's life because Jesus wasn't worried that death would infect him. See, Jesus knew that he could step in and touch the death in life and he would infect it. And so if you're experiencing death, some brokenness in your life, I want you to know, just like Jesus was willing to touch that, Jesus is willing to touch our life, right? And it says the bear stood still. They were shocked that the rabbi would touch it. And he said, young man, I say to you, get up. And then something that they didn't expect happened. It says the dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. Now listen, I've never seen a dead person come back to life. And whenever I read this or see this, there's always a part of me that's in shock. But the good news is the empty tomb and the fact that there's a risen Jesus, that the apostle Paul, who was an original disciple, who persecuted the church, and the only reason he became a disciple is because he encountered a risen Jesus. Because of the eyewitness testimony of a risen Jesus, because the tomb is empty, I know that there was power that Jesus had that is outside of what I know. And then it goes on and it says this. It says, they were filled with awe and they praised God. A great prophet has appeared among us. And they said, God has come to help. And that's what you and I need to hear this morning. In the midst of this mood in our country, in our world, that can leave us in a fog of despair, we need to hear the good news that God has come to help. God has not abandoned the world. Yes, you and I will experience the brokenness in this world that tries to ruin the beauty of life, but God has come to help. And this news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. And here's where you and I, in the midst of this fog of despair, you and I need to hear this morning. I want to share with you through this encounter that they didn't expect, something that is amazing and awesome. First is that, listen, even though they were blinded by grief and despair, Jesus was on the way. Listen, Jesus is on the way in our lives and in our communities, in our world, to do something that we won't see and didn't know was coming. I mean, Jesus is on his way. And if we're really honest, in moments and seasons of despair, we are often blinded by grief. But Jesus reminds us that he is on the way. He will show up. And here's the second thing, is that Jesus was willing to step into the messy death part of life. And he wasn't worried about being infected by brokenness, but that he would bring his life and power. And then here's my third observation from this awesome passage is this, is that Jesus brings life and power to do what we can't. Listen, over the last several weeks, we've talked about some really hard issues, right? And some of them, we don't have human solutions. And I've been saying since the beginning of South Point, my hope is not in politics. My hope is not in technology. My hope isn't in wealth. My hope isn't in education. My hope is in a person who conquered hell and death, and his name is Jesus. And this morning, you and I can have hope in this truth that I just wanted to remind us of so that we could have joy and hope in our hearts. And I'm going to put it up on the screen, and it's this right here. Crooked doesn't win. The brokenness that tries to ruin the beauty of life doesn't win. Just type in amen in the chat this morning, right? Crooked doesn't win. Christ does. And you know how I know Christ does? Is because the tomb is empty. You and I may argue or disagree if you're not a follower or have different faith, but the reality is the historical fact is the tomb is empty and there were people who encountered a risen Christ. You and I can have hope, and our hope can turn despair into something beautiful. Crooked doesn't win, Christ does. Which leads us to the next point that I want to share, and it's this. Jesus replaces our despair with hope. You see, I don't have hope because of what I see on the outside. I don't have hope in systems and structures. I have hope in a living God, and his name is Jesus, and he conquered hell and death. And this morning, even though we've had some difficult conversations over the last 3 weeks, and to be honest, in our busted and broken world, we'll need to continue to have hard and difficult conversations. And in the midst of those difficult and hard conversations, I have hope because of Jesus. I have hope because of him. And here's the most amazing thing. Hope transforms our response. Let me say this, like I just want you to focus. If you could just lean in with me a little bit. Hope can transform our response. And here's what I mean. I'm going to put it up. You see, hope is remembering that God has the habit of showing up to do what we can't. You see, hope doesn't deny the brokenness of the world, right? Hope doesn't deny that there's real pain and there's real problem. Hope actually allows us to do something different. Hope transforms our response to the brokenness. And here's what I mean by it transforms our response. We're going to put it up on the screen here, and it's this. You see, where despair would cause us to retreat. So you see, despair would ask us to step away, to like medicate, to step away and go, I'm not going to engage. I'm just going to worry about me. Where despair would say, I need to fortify. I'm not going to care about other human beings. I'm going to harden my heart. I'm going to build a wall where no one hurts me. I'm going to let my love grow cold. I'm going to build a wall where I'm going to isolate, where I'm only going to be around people who make me feel good about me and my thoughts and my ideas. And I'm going to isolate. And where despair would ask us to not be what we're meant to be and make the world not a better place. The amazing thing is that the hope of Jesus, right? The hope of Jesus causes you and I to respond differently. Where despair would say to retreat, hope tells you and I we can step up and serve. Where the world is going, I'm going to have a cancel culture and I'm going to step away, it causes you and I that name the name of Jesus to not retreat, but to step up and serve people. Whether they love us or like us or agree with us, we can step up and serve. I like what Dr. Johnny Parker told me the other day as we were having a conversation. Christians show up not to be loved. Christians show up to love other people. And we can do that. Hope causes us to serve. Hope will cause us to build bridges. You know, those things that we used to build walls, we can now use those things to build bridges across with people who disagree with us or dislike us, who are hurting, who are disenfranchised, who are oppressed, who are hurting. We can build bridges with people. Did you know we can be for people without having to agree with everything that they do or they believe? Hope in Jesus causes us to build bridges with people that are made in the image of God. Hope transforms my response to the brokenness. I will not despair. I will not isolate. I will reconcile. I will cross that bridge that I've built to love people and point them to a God who loved them and a God who made them and a God who wants to be their friend. The hope causes me to love and to be for people, even if they're different, even if they hurt me. I want to be reconciled to them because they are made in the image of God and they have dignity and I can give them the respect that they deserve as an image bearer. Do you see? Despair will cause us to step away. It'll cause us to not be better or make the world better. But hope in Jesus means that you and I will actually have a different response to both the brokenness on the inside and the brokenness on the outside. Hope will cause us to do something different, to serve, to build, and to reconcile. And it leaves us, if I was going to tie up the message in just like one simple statement this morning, I would say it this way. Despair tells us to give up, right? And if we're all honest, haven't we all been tempted in the last couple months, right, to just give up? You know, just between all the brokenness, right? The brokenness that ruins the beauty of life, to throw our hands up in the air and to go, I give up. And here's good news this morning, right? Hope beyond the darkness. Hope tells us to step up. I want to encourage you, no matter where you're at today, to not fall into or to give into despair that tells us to give up and walk away. That as followers of Jesus, that we would be people to step up. And here's why God calls us to step up, because humanity has never had a generation that the love and of power of God to transform that generation. Here's what I know to be true. Matter of fact, Jesus tells us this, that there is nothing that can stop the church. I want to put the scripture up on the screen. It's this. Jesus' own words said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not conquer it. Listen, church, I want you to know this morning, we are not going to hide. The church will not be silent and the church will not give up because Jesus built his church. He is going to support his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. His power and his love has the ability to transform this generation. There is hope and it will and can get better. Now, for some of you, you might be going, Matt, like you're a pastor, you're just overly optimistic, like the world's going to hell in a handbasket, right? Like how can we create change? And so I want to share a picture with you and I'm going to put it up on the screen. But before I want to do, and here it is up here, and I want to kind of share what's going on. This picture is at the Roman Colosseum, and it's at the entrance, and this was called the Emperor's Entrance. And this is where the emperor would come in, and he would sit, and he would watch the gladiators who would fight to the death and give them that kind of thumbs up, thumb down. This is where the emperor would come in and watch as Christians, right? Christians, Christ followers, those who named the name of Jesus, would be covered in animal clothes and then given to sport as lions chased them, mauled them, and ate them, as Christians were tortured for the crowd's entertainment. And I want you to notice something. And I've actually been there. I have a picture on my phone of this cross. Where the emperors used to sit there and play God, there is a cross representing. It used to be a symbol of death, a symbol of torture, a symbol of crooked and brokenness. And that symbol of death and crookedness now speaks to something else. People don't go to Rome to celebrate the emperors that walk through those gates. People don't go to Rome to see the death that was taken there, but they go to see the tombs of saints and see people like where the Apostle Paul was buried. You see, in this season where the world was broken and it was ruining the beauty of life, those Christians in this season had the same challenge that you and I face today, right? That is the despair, right? The despair to retreat, the despair to fortify, the despair to isolate. And because they knew the tomb was empty, because there had been people who had encountered an eyewitness risen Jesus, because they knew the main message of Jesus was to love your neighbor like Christ loved you, they chose not to despair. And even though there was this racial divide between Jewish people and Gentiles, they began to love one another and to cross and to serve one another and to build bridges and to reconcile, right? And to love one another the way Christ called them to love. And though there was slaves and masters, Jesus told us that all people are made in the image of God, and the church became a place of community where there were masters and slaves, and all people were given dignity and respect, and there was freedom in Christ that the world didn't have, that all people are made in the image of God. There were those who were oppressed and marginalized, women who were seen as objects and second-class citizens, but yet Jesus brought them into the fold and gave them places of hope and authority, right? And we see that they were made, and the church was made up of that. The helpless and the marginalized. Back in those days, babies would be left out in the street to die because they weren't born of the right gender, or they weren't perfect and they had defects. Who was it that gathered the babies off the streets? It was Christians, because they didn't despair, because they decided that they would step up, that they would build bridges, and that they would reconcile. There was a generation that stepped up in hope. And the Roman Empire wasn't conquered by a foreign army. Its culture was changed from the inside out by a small band of people who didn't give in to despair, but they allowed hope to transform how they would act and live. And they just chose daily to step up. They chose daily to build bridges. They chose daily to reconcile the world to God and to each other. And they changed the course of human history. And their generation won. And so I want to encourage us, no matter what part of the world you're in, no matter what part of the country you're in, though it feels like we should despair, this is a great opportunity for those of us who are followers of Jesus today to let the light of God's love shine brightly into the darkness that is the brokenness that is ruining the beauty of life. For people to see hope in a person named Jesus, and that you and I can bring hope to a world that is in desperate need of it, and that God's power and His love can do what we can, that our generation can be changed, and it will be changed, because that's what Jesus does. He brings life where there is death. And this is our hope this morning. So thank you for joining us. Let me pray. Hey God, you rock. God, even when we can't see it, you are stepping in. You are coming our way. God, that you love us and your heart breaks for the brokenness. And God, that you are willing to step into the messy and the dead places and touch our lives, God. And God, that when you show up, you do what only you can do. And God, that our hope is that you have a habit of showing up to do what we can. And God, so our eyes are upon you. And God, we're not going to despair. We're not going to give up. God, we are going to step up because that's what you did. We're going to do what you called us to do. We're going to love our neighbor the way that you have loved us. And so God, I pray, God, that your hope would shine brightly in our hearts. God, I pray that you would protect us and strengthen us. And may we who named the name of Jesus would step up and would build bridges and would be reconcilers so the world could see how much you love and that they could experience your love and your transforming power. This is our hope and our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for joining us. I hope you have a great Sunday. God bless.